So, good morning. How are you doing? Thank you for sharing your time with me today. It's a pleasure to be here. As you said, I did my bachelor here, then my scholarship, I did my PhD in social communication, and then I left. And then I left for two things, for love, and because there were not many opportunities here. And then I got a postdoc. I will explain that later to visit, but the thing is that when I was doing my PhD, and this is something I discovered later, nobody explained me many things that would have been very useful to us. And I find that it's a pity that I'm not to be very honest today. I mean, I'm invited by the university, but I'm not to say bad things about universities. Because I think it's necessary that even the people working at the university realize that they need to do things in a different way to get you in the right track so you can develop your careers and you can develop the most of your skills, okay? So I'm going to say things that also to you, because you're doing things wrong. And you're being too comfortable sometimes in your position. So, yeah, I'm going to say many things. I don't bring solutions. I bring questions. Hopefully, today you leave these 2 hours with many questions that will make your life a bit more difficult. But that's the point. The point is that if you don't make yourself the right questions in the right time, then it's going to be, whoops! Reality is here. I'm late. Okay? So before we go into all that, at the same time I want to tell you, I have just 3 or 4 slides. I haven't prepared more, not because I'm lazy, it's because I want you to talk also. Okay? I don't want this just to be like a delivery here, and then I leave, and that's it. I really want to hear from you, I want your questions, and I want to shape these 2 hours according to your needs. Otherwise, it has no value. If I just come here, explain my life, how great it is, how well I'm doing now in Switzerland, what is it for? It's of no use. But I want to hear your questions. So, while I introduce myself and what I do, think questions, okay? Think what you want to know about what is coming, what's the future, how can you deal with the future, okay? So, here's where I work. This is the European Broadcasting Union. The European Broadcasting Union, or EBU, is the Professional Association of Public Service Broadcasters. What we do is supporting their interests, defending their interests, so basically we are a lobbying group and we develop many activities and I will show you a video. And actually it's a very nice place to work. It's a company with 16 years of history and very international. Hello, phones off. And we do many things in terms of development, of research, of training, of people working in the public televisions. So it's a nice place to be. We have 73 members. It's a professional association. So we have 73 members from 56 countries. So my daily day, I talk with people from 6, 7, 8 countries on the phone or by email. It's very international. Our members, our public service televisions and radio provide all these services, like 800 TV channels, more than 1,000 radio stations, in 122 languages, with a potential audience of more than 1 million European citizens. So, it's a quite cool place to work, and this is just for you to have an idea of the international perspective I have. I'm lucky enough to have working in this company. In dark blue you see the countries where we have members. And now I'm going to show you a short video of what we do, because it's easy to understand. By the way, yes, we are the ones that do the Eurovision Song Contest. But I have nothing to do with that, okay? So, let's jump to the video. Here we are. Maybe I will switch off the lights.
In 1950, public service media from 23 countries joined forces to create the European Broadcasting Union. Today, we're the most influential broadcasting union in the world, with members in 56 countries across Europe and beyond. Together, our members operate hundreds of TV channels and radio stations, reaching over 1 billion people in more than 120 languages. With a multilingual staff from over 40 countries, we offer first-class media services, and we create communities to share experience, best practice, and knowledge. We help set industry standards in areas like HDTV and digital radio, develop innovative solutions to transform the way we broadcast, and we are the voice of public service media. We defend the public interest by campaigning to strengthen and support public service media, to allow our members to inform, educate, and entertain audiences around the world. Exchanges help broadcasters cover breaking news stories 24 hours a day. And our special events team makes sure journalists can report live from where the news is happening. We exchange and transmit over 3,300 concerts each year, from classical to opera, and offer wide exposure to rock, pop, dance, folk, and world music. And we provide a comprehensive sports service, from negotiating rights for around 150 events every year to providing post-broadcasting services. Our fiber optic and satellite network is the largest of its kind, connecting broadcasters across the globe. It carries around 100,000 hours of live news and sports coverage every year. And we also produce the biggest live entertainment show in the world, uniting 200 million people every day, the Eurovision Song Contest. For over 60 years, we've brought our members and their audiences closer together. The EBU, making public service media indispensable.
So, this is my work, and as I said before, it's a quite nice place to be, because as you see, we do plenty of things, thank you, yes. We do plenty of things from development to lobbying in Brussels, helping our members to develop content, making possible that the content reaches their houses, all these kind of things. And what is that I do? Well, I'm the head of the research department, and I was hired 4 years ago. I didn't have previous market experience, I just was working at university, but there was this position, so I applied. And when I was hired, they told me something. They told me, we just fired the entire department. We wanted to create something new. And then something quite interesting, they told me, listen, this is not university, we are interested in the truth, we not always communicate all the truth. And why I'm saying this is because you are going to face that if you do research outside university, and it's something you need to get used to. Okay? So, basically, 1 minute to summarize what was my job, so you have an idea of what I did, and how I have reached this position, and what was in between, and what were the decisions I took. So I studied audiovisual communication here in the UPF. I graduated in 2001, got a scholarship from the regional government for doing a PhD. The scholarship was for 4 years. It took 8 years to do my PhD. And I did my master thesis in 4 years. It's not that I was lazy, so I was doing plenty of things like teaching, working for professors, all these kind of things that, of course, taught me a lot, and I learned a lot, but I also wasted a lot of time somehow. At that time, it wasn't very useful to, or very, very usual for people here in Barcelona to go abroad to do research stages in other universities. But I went to Sweden for half a year in 2004 because my PhD was in comparing national public policies for deploying digital terrestrial television. And I compared Sweden and Spain, so I went to Sweden. I was there for half a year. And that opened my mind. And how many of you are not from Spain? Quite a lot. Good. So, I don't know if you are suffering the reverse process. But certainly, I don't know at this point because I have lost a bit of contact with the university, but certainly in 2004 when I left and after my experience here, meeting certain professors, seeing certain attitudes towards research, really opened my mind. And I got in love with a German. I went to Sweden, got in love with a German, not good business. But then I came back and I couldn't stay anymore because I didn't fit anymore. I changed. I didn't fit. I was annoying my colleagues with questions, annoying questions. Why don't we do this? Why don't we do this? Why don't we do this? And yeah, and the person I love was in Germany, so I left Germany. I reached an agreement with my professor, I will come from time to time to do the teaching I had to do. They were nice enough to concentrate my teaching. And then that was for 4 years. I delivered my PhD in 2009. I was still in Germany, and I really had started to think, what am I going to do? And especially if you come from social science. How many of you are from social science? It's got to be hard. But people say, so what do you do? What's the value of what you do? How many engineers? It's a bit easier for you. You do things that can be sold this morning. Things that are connected to technology. So it's a bit easier. But in many cases, what is going to happen is that you will see that the real world is not evolving the same path and the same direction that you are. And you need to readjust, and that can be difficult. So, when I was finishing my PhD, I was starting to think, so what am I going to do next? Because at the university, they can't offer me any job. I don't want to come back to Spain, obviously. And so, I discovered the Marie Curie Fellowships. Do you know them? Good thing. Very difficult. I will talk about that later. I applied twice. First time was rejected. Okay. Second time I was rejected. But then, when reading the report they give to you, I saw, oh man, they haven't read my application because the report actually saying things that don't match with the application. Like we have talked about this. Yes, I have. So I opened a procedure to have my application being reviewed again. And then I got the money. So I got 170,000 euros for 2 years to do my research in Germany because I was already living there. I didn't declare I was there, otherwise I couldn't have done the Marie Curie there. So that's also important to know, in case I will talk about that later. But I already had an agreement, of course, with a research institute there, the Hans Bredow Institute, which is the most important research institute in media science in Germany, and I was there for 2 years. But already by the end of the first year, I realized they couldn't keep me because, again, money at university, everybody's very happy to welcome you, to bring your own money, as I did. And it was very nice to work there for 2 years, I learned a lot. But then by the end of the first year, I really was very anxious because I was thinking, what is next? So you know, I finished my postdoc, I delivered a report, and I was unemployed. I tried to come back to Spain. I got 6 months negotiation with the Ramon Llull University. They wanted me to be the head of research. They offered me 55,000 euros. Very good. Back then, when it wasn't the moment to sign the contract, by the way, in all these negotiations, there was no contract. Everything was verbal, personal. And then I was trying to convince my wife back already, okay, let's go back to Barcelona. And she told me, oh, listen, there's a crisis and all these things. But yeah, let's go back to Barcelona. And there was no contract, yes. And then she started to make me questions. So it's like, because she was pregnant, we were about to have a child. So she was asking about parenting time, folks' holidays, working hours, all these kind of things. And after shaking hands with the dean of the faculty at the time, and after having this kind of personal agreement, okay, I will take this job, then I sent these questions. I invested 4 hours in writing an email because I knew they would not like those questions. And I knew that I need to sound not demanding, okay? What happened is they called me the next day and told me, listen, we're not going to hire you because you don't fit in this company. You have been traveling around. You are like a European public officer. What is this thing about asking for holidays? What is this thing about asking parental time? You know, someone got a baby here, he was out the days his wife was in the hospital. Of course, I tried to solve the situation because I really wanted to come back to Barcelona. I was missing my friends, my family. This is a great place to be. So I tried to, I'm sorry, I didn't want to meet you. And then he told me, okay, let's talk on Monday. This was a Friday, let's talk on Monday. And then during the weekend, I realized, this is a trap. For months, they have been telling me that they wanted something, but they don't realize that they don't want what they are telling me. They are not ready to have me as head of research because I'm going to change everything they do. And if the first thing they tell me is that, because I'm making questions, I don't fit the culture of the company, because they told me, here you come to work. As many hours as necessary. By the way, it was a 50 hours contract. So I asked, but listen, I'm paying all my social security, as you know, for my pension. I told them, I'm really to take the contract like this, if this means you have to pay like less cost for you. But I want to know. Exactly. No way. So I didn't got the contract. On Monday when the man called me back, and after checking with my parents, with my friends, with myself, basically I told him, you know what, you're right. I don't fit in your company. And by the way, because he had told me, oh, these are the questions of your German wife. I said, you know, you have been very impolite. And it's, for you, the fact that having a family, it's a problem. I really don't want to work for you. But then I was still unemployed, okay? But lucky enough, and this is luck, then there was this job position. I applied. I went through a 2 hours interview with the director general, a very bright woman, who actually made me sweat physically in the meeting. I thought there was some heating in the chair. It was like my kidneys. Because I got so many questions. How are you going to solve this? How are you going to solve that? What would you do if our members would say that the research we do is shit? That's what she asked me, all these kinds of questions. There, I was not understanding why all these questions. Then, when I got the job, I saw the situation, and I understood why. And honestly, she didn't care about my PhD. She just wanted to get to know me and see if I would be able to deliver, if I look convinced enough, if I had the skills to deliver what they needed. Since I'm there, I have done 6 recruitment processes. Tomorrow I have interviews with a visiting researcher who we will have for 1 year. You know what? I have realized about something. Recruiting processes are extremely cruel. You got 15 seconds chance. When I open a CV, it's 15 seconds, the time I need to decide if that person fits or not. For this position, I got 100 CVs. 100. So it's opening. I would suggest don't put a photo. Si es pura foto, and you feel something about that photo. You like or you don't like that person. And even if you try to be extremely professional, the photo says something. Or if you put a photo, be careful about the photo you put there. You know? Don't put the photo like this, too close, then use sunglasses, don't be too cool, don't do it with your webcam. Okay? Then, internet is there. I check the internet. I find anybody I recruit in the internet. And for many of them, before I hire them, I already knew what kind of food they like, where they have been traveling, who are their friends, if they got drunk. So, be aware that your life is there, and you need to put boundaries, and you need to cut, and you need to curate your public image in the internet. It's extremely important. Because even if you have the best PhD ever, the best project, you are dealing with humans, and humans have prejudgments, and humans are visual, and they see things. And when I have 100 cities to review, besides my job, I don't have much time. So what I do is I see, okay, what's the education, fine, the jobs. Listen, don't include the list of your publications. Nobody's going to read that. Okay, these 100 publications, these 100 presentations, it's just paper, paper, paper. Maximum 2 pages. What are your skills? That's an important question. So when I recruit someone, and I don't care what that person has studied. I mean, I do, of course, because they need to be connected to the field. But, honestly, it's not so much about a master or a PhD or whatever. It's with that. I know what I'm saying is very difficult to get, but it's about the feeling that CV is giving to you. If it's poorly done, you say, okay, this person is not going to deliver a great box, a great graphics. If it's too much, but then the content is empty, okay, this person is not going to deliver a content. If it's explaining your life to the detail, okay, this person is not able to summarize. And think that usually what people are doing when checking CVs is getting looking for the negative stuff more than the positive. Somehow the human brain is shaped in a way that we look for the negative, for the dangers. Okay? So you need to work on your CV very much. It's very important. And the CV needs to explain, okay, who you are, what you have done, what you have studied, especially what is that you're able to do, what are your skills. And especially don't overclaim. Okay? You can make it a bit nice, but avoid adjectives like, I'm a superb researcher. Yeah, well, let me decide that. That's my question. I want to say these adjectives. That happens a lot. I'm sorry if there's any American. That happens with Americans. Americans tend to use a lot of adjectives. And say, well, and then you have the opposite. The opposite is the people from Eastern Europe that because of the cultural background, then when you interview them, they are frozen and paralyzed. And you ask them, why should I hire you? And they say, I know. Literally. Poor people, I suffer. Actually, my team, and they ask me all the time, bring a Polish. Because whenever we have a Polish, and now it's the Polish moments, these people have difficulties to present themselves. So actually this is also something very important. Besides your CV, you need to prepare yourself for the interviews you will have. And it's very easy and difficult at the same time because you need to be yourself. If you pretend being someone different, people respect that. And you need to understand what's the job you're applying for, what's the position, what is that they want. So you really need to do research into the company and be really in that interview to explain who you are, to be very honest, and to say, okay, I think, honestly, in a very calm way, this is what I can bring to your team. And I'm talking about this because actually, doing a PhD is what makes the difference to the rest of the world. Not because the topic you have done, it's because how these 4 to 8 years are shaping your brain. And that's what makes you special and different, in my opinion. You know why? With my colleague David, who was from the Autonomous University and I recruited 1 year after, nowadays we still freak out when we just get some data, some sentences, okay, big volume of information, and then we are able to put a graphic that summarizes everything in one table, you know, like a map of concepts. And you show it to professionals, people from the podcast, and say, whoa, science. But that's the reality. You are doing something that the rest of the human beings can't do. That is managing huge volumes of information, putting it together, and making sense out of it. And if you are able to explain it in a way that people actually understand it, that's your added value. It doesn't matter if you are from social science or you are an engineer. This is what the PhD gives you that no audience has. And this is a very, very, very high value that companies are looking for. Okay? So, stop talking about myself and let's talk about you. Questions? What do you want to know? Yes?
Because we're giving general tips about data, including addiction and so on and so forth. I was wondering about children, because I know 20 years ago in Germany you would put it, now you don't put it. Now I'm wondering whether maybe now it's going to change again and maybe you can tell that your child is an additional task you have, or would you suggest?
It depends very much from company to company. You don't need to give much details about your personal life. That will come later. In the interview, eventually you have to say that, because of course you want to know if the company that you want to work for is child friendly. Well, I mean, I have two of them, and sometimes they get sick and they need to leave. And you know, some companies will say, okay, fine, no way, no problem. But not, I wouldn't say put it in the CV. Society. Okay. More general question. So what are you afraid of? How many are you delivering your PhD this year? Do you have a plan already? No?
For me it's more or less like for you, because I'm teaching at the same time. I'm finishing the PhD, I have my hand for the pregnancy at the same time. So it's pretty much a fight every month or every 3 months. In one way, I don't want to leave Barcelona, but on the other way, I don't want to just stick around and wait for whatever happens, if it happens, when it happens. So basically, for now, I have my application here at the UPF, I'm a professor here. But what further, I don't know. Because I'm doing my PhD in law. I was working with European agencies already. I was working with the European Court of Justice already in Luxembourg before. But I'm not quite sure what my next step is. Because the positions here are really scarce. Even more so if you're not from a Spanish legal system, that you are not trained before here. Mm-hmm. So there's no mindedness here.
You have to leave.
Don't tell me that I'm very
scared. But it's okay, you know why? I'm telling you something. Barcelona is very nice, it has many cars, it's expensive. If you live on money here, I live in Geneva. Barcelona is super cheap for me, just 1 hour away, I can come whenever I want. And I enjoy it as a tourist, and it's like super cheap.
I'm so glad I'm not quite as good as that, because you just opened the company that's based completely here, so if you hear that.
Yeah, you can also do that. How many of you are thinking to stay here? Okay, the others will leave. Back to your country? No? Where are you from?
American.
American? Oh, you're Trump now. Yeah. I mean, my basic message today is that you need a plan, or two, or three, or four. Probably none of them is going to work as it was planned, but I think you need to actively design your life. You need to actively think, what is that you want? What is that you want doesn't mean I want to be a professor in this or that. Or, no, because that you never know if it's going to happen. But do you want money? Is it money important for you? Or is what you do and the content? And I guess most of you are going to say, oh, it's the content, you know. See, I'm a research. I'm a good guy. Yes. But wait for the money there and then you forget about all that. It's true. It happens. It's slowly, but it happens. Again, for you, is it important, like living in a place like Barcelona with sun, with the Ramblas, with the sea, with all these things? Or are you ready to live somewhere in Sweden doing the best research in Kiruna, the North Indian astrophysics with no sun and no light, the snow? Maybe you want that. So it's very important that you really picture who you are and that you are honest. So what you are. And secondly, it's very important, and this is even more important because it will shape the answers to the other things. What is that you are good at? And we, in many cases, we lie to ourselves. What it means to be a researcher at university nowadays? It means you don't have private life. How many of you work during the weekends? Losers. The best thing that has happened to me living in university is that I don't work anymore on weekends. Weekends are for my family. But you know what? I'm 1,000 times more productive in the 8 hours I work per day. Because I know I need to work those 8 hours, so there is no other things to do but working. I don't take coffee, I don't do this, I don't do that, okay? Then, for example, do you like writing papers? How many of you like writing papers? All the others, you can be a professor. Because for being a professor, you need to write many papers. I didn't like writing papers. And nobody reads them. You know, the changing point in my life was when I published this article, you know, about a dissertation in this special issue of a magazine, of a journal, and then I received the printed copy, and I was very proud, and I immediately opened to see my name there, and I called my mom and I said, listen, I got this thing published, blah, 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 and then I left the journal on the shelf next to other books. I didn't read all the articles. And some months later, I saw it there, and I thought, this was a special issue on my topic. I didn't read it. What does it mean? This means nobody has read my paper, my article. And then I thought, well, why am I doing this? I don't like writing. And then, it's a lot of work. Most of the research get published late because of the submission, reviewing. And actually, I can tell you something, I don't know. I mean, each field of knowledge is different, of course. But in social science, in media studies, where I do, and now I work with professionals, nobody reads that. Basically, this means the knowledge that is produced at university stays at university, not even if people at university read it. It's useless. It's useless. All these written papers are useless. They only are useful for those doing a PhD that find your thing, then we write it in a different way. And here we are feeling each other, and you know. Meanwhile, reality is developing in another way. What I have realized is that outside the university are plenty of opportunities. And as I told you, you have a gift. You can do things with knowledge. You can manage information. in a way many people out there think it's magic. And it's not about your PhD in the topic, of course it's about that. But it's not only about that, it's about the set of skills you have and how these can bring value to companies. And that's what you need to think about. You need to think about what is that I'm good at. So I realized I didn't like writing papers. I like teaching, but less and less, because the students are becoming weird. And as you can see, I like to give presentations. And my wife told me for many years, listen, it's like you are in a bubble compressed and you are not developing your skills. And I said, come on, you know, I even got in fights with her. No, but you know, university, I'm doing the good thing, the good thing. I don't want to go to the market. And now I'm in the market, and I will never go back to university. Because I have realized that in many cases, and I won't offend anybody that is religious, but universities are like sectors of religious systems. Because they tell you, listen, there is a golden future out there being a professor. But wait a second, it's not so easy. You need to do a journey. And it's a painful journey. You're going to suffer. You need to demonstrate. You need to learn. And it's time you think you have achieved something. So you're already looking for the next step, right? And it's again, and in many cases, when you have new ideas, people say, oh, no, 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 stick to the rules here, right? So in that sense, it's like a religion. It's like this myth of the, how you say that in English, from Plato, the people that were in the cave, remember? And people from the outside came with light and said, no, no, that's not reality. And it's a bit like that. And then you go outside and you realize that all those skills you have can actually develop. So now I basically don't do research anymore. I manage researchers. I have a team, and my job is to make possible that they do their research in the best conditions and that we get fantastic results, and those results transfer to our members, and it changes the way they operate. We sometimes rescue broadcasters from the government's cutting their budget just because we do research. And we are able to bring them to the politicians, to scare the politicians like shit, and then they look at the money. That is having an impact. And, of course, it depends on the field, because if you are doing, like, development of vaccinations or things like that, of course, you need a lab. You cannot need so much on your own. You depend on a certain system. But again, don't be afraid of leaving university. There is plenty of money. Money, there is money. Listen, there is money because people will see that you have capabilities and they will pay you for that. They will pay you for that. And the university, honestly, that doesn't work. And I think that's one of the biggest mistakes of universities, at least here in Spain. You know, sometimes I try to work with universities. They are cheaper than consultancy companies. And the main problem always for me is that universities tell me, no, listen, the money you will pay will not go to the pocket of the researcher. I say, what? How is that? The money will be used to buy chairs, to buy computers, to buy... I say, no. I don't want my money to go to that. I want my money to go to the researchers. I want the money to go to your pockets so you have fantastic holidays. You enjoy yourself, and next year you want to work for me again and to do the best you can. Because in the end, of course, money does not equal happiness, but it helps, and it helps a lot. And I wouldn't say that 10 years ago when I was doing my PhD, but it really does. And then you have children, and you want to do holidays, and things like that. Yes.
What if your field of research is kind of, not impossible, but very difficult to be taken out of university and used by some company or something?
What's your field?
It's Japanese pre-modern history.
Jesus.
And at the same time, you don't want to leave that field, even if you think that you have super skills to do some of the things.
Yeah.
I think like that.
Yeah.
You choose that strange field because you love it. And at the same time, there are not many positions in the
Okay. Let's do a quick coaching for him. Do you speak Japanese?
Yeah.
Great. Do you understand Japanese culture?
Yeah.
Yes.
I think.
Have you been to Japan so many times?
Yeah.
Good. What do you think he can do? I will tell you something. In Japan, 85% of the companies have problems to find skilled people. Because foreigners are right to Japan, they are lost when they leave. So, could you think that you could use the things? The problem is that you are looking at your problem and your issues saying, I'm doing this, I want to continue to do this. Let's refresh. Forget about what you do and think about what you love. What is that you like? What do you like about this? Let's say, do you like that you are learning about cultural stuff? You're learning about history? So, could you imagine that all the knowledge you have, I bet you have read a lot, that all this knowledge could be useful to someone else? Imagine working or setting your own company to help Japanese companies to recruit high-level talent.
It will pay and it will offer.
He's ready to compromise my money.
Free time to work on what is it,
you see? Well, the question is, these are the questions you need to make yourself. Don't think about the past, I want to be this. Think about what you love, what you like, think about what you are good at, and think about also, this is something I read yesterday, what's the pain you are ready to take? Are you ready to go to Japan and live there and not seeing your family every weekend? But this
depends on what you said about family. I mean, I would take my wife and my child.
Okay, good.
But
is your family ready for that? Because sometimes, you know? But these are the questions. And it's very difficult to do this on your own. You know what's the best thing I did when I had the Marie Curie? There was a part of the budget that was for traveling for interviews and for doing things that would help you to get the next job. So I used the money to get a coach, a professional coach. Because I was kind of lost, saying, okay, I have done this, I don't see the way to continue this path. I speak German, but not to a level that a German university would hire me, because they really want you to write papers in German. Possible. I don't know if I want to go to the market. I was not sure about many things. So I got this 10 sessions with this lady, a coach that helped me to understand, as I said, what is that I like, what's important to me, what is that I want. The first question she made was, what kind of car you would like to buy? I said, what are we talking about? Because, for example, for men, depending on the car you want, seems to say how important money is for you. How important is for you to get recognition from your peers? How important for you is to be visible, popular? How important for you is money or content, accomplishing things, bringing good to society? So during these 10 sessions, that was like going to the psychologist, but it was very good, and taking some personality tests, and basically we were mapping myself, mapping what was important for me. And then, when you get the picture, and you actually get to know who you are, then you need to confront and say, listen, is university matching this picture of me? Are my values, my skills, what drives me? Is it available at university? If it is, congratulations, it's at university. But if it's not, leave university. And I know it's difficult, right? Because you have invested all that money, all that time, all those hours reading, you are so focused, you want to be a professor, you got your accreditation for teaching, and now we are telling you that you need to leave that behind and jump to somewhere else, to the market, where actually you can be fired sometimes, or not. I got a permanent contract, and when they sent me my first salary, then I went to Geneva, I saw how much things cost there. Now I make 50% more. And I make 50% more because I'm delivering. And I went to my boss and I said, I have my money. Oh, I did. I said, yeah, here you have more money. And I said, I want more researchers. I said, here you have more researchers. And I want more budget. I said, here you have more budget. Try to move it here. First of all, you need to fill so many papers. And then, you know? So again, it's get a coach. It costs money. I remember paying 150 euros per hour. Do it. Invest. It's an investment in yourself. But you need to be clear. You know? I was lying to myself. I thought I like to write papers. Hey. And I realize I'm good at managing people, and I'm good at managing processes. And in the last 4 years, and that experience was last week, I realized that maybe one day I'm going to leave this job, and I'm going to leave maybe the media market. Because I have realized that I'm good at facilitating that people make up their mind about difficult questions. Like, last week I was in Lugano with the management board of the broadcaster there, and it was basically 12 directors of different departments, and I was there just trying to make them understand what's the main goal of their company and getting them to set agreement between themselves to define a strategy for the company. So basically I was a facilitator. And I was there, and I thought, well, I'm quite good at doing this. Could I make a living of this? Could I make this outside of the media market for any other company? Doesn't matter, for people that have a company about historic Japanese things. Could I help them? The question is, yes, because it doesn't matter the topic. Of course the topic matters, you need to be familiar. But it's about a set of skills. So now, I'm very, let's say, relax. If someday I get fired, or if someday I don't get a job anymore in the media sector, I know that I have a set of skills. And I know that with a bit of time, and fans are, you know, making money and saving money so I can be relaxed, I will then create something or reposition myself in the market, because again, it's about skills. It's not about degrees. I'm talking too much. Questions?
You said that now you're sort of managing researchers. So could you give an example of how the research you're now managing in the private sector differs from the research you were doing at the university?
Good. So, we have a team of 4 researchers and myself. And then we have another person that is taking care of that everything we do. It's published and promoted and everything. And we get a visiting researcher every year. So it's 5 people. You know how many projects we do in a year? 25 projects. 25 research projects. Besides that, I have done 26 business trips this year to give presentations. And besides that, we have a service. That means that any person from any of those companies that are members in 56 countries, they can call at any time and ask whatever, and we get it done. In the sense of, oh, tomorrow we have a meeting with our parliament, they want to cut our budget, I need a comparison. comparison, benchmarking our company structure, funding, blah, 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 with other companies in other countries with similar situations. 25 minutes is done. Because we have systematized all our data collection, we have invested 4 years. We saw 450 requests like that in a year, plus 25 research projects, plus trips. You see why I say that productivity has gone up like crazy? Because our projects don't last more than 6 months. It's extremely applied because we are targeting professionals. They don't care about the theoretical framework. No way. I mean, it's extremely important that the theoretical framework is there. Three people in my team, we have a PhD, and we have done research before. So our brains are shaped in a certain way. We have all that knowledge. We don't need to rewrite that every single time. What professionals want are the results. And because the people we target, TV, radio managers, don't have more than 5 minutes to check what you have done, we don't write anymore. We just do graphics. Titles, graphics, and if they want to know more, they call us. And then we explain to them. And the writing style is totally different. And how to manage these people? I didn't have a business background. I'm now taking some business courses, some management courses, and some strategic thinking courses, besides all the work and the family and everything. The managing, it's very important. All of you need to learn management, I think. Because, you know, we have knowledge. And many people will say, oh, well, the last 10 years you were at university. Well, you were at university, you didn't work. Work experience, zero. It's not true. I mean, you have jobs here. But when people see your CVs, what do they say? Well, you don't have job experience. So actually, if you need to compete with professionals that have been on the market for many years, it's very difficult to compete face to face. That's why I was saying you need to emphasize the skills that the others will not have. And I would say you need somehow, first of all, project management. You need to be able to deliver. And you need to be able to tell people, listen, that's your problem, this is your problem. Okay. What are the questions that we want to answer? There's 6 questions in a dissertation. Okay, what do we need to do to answer these questions, this kind of research? How much time? How many resources? What are going to be the results? How are we going to promote them? How are we going to make sure the people in the company understand them? You need to be able to manage these things. And now that I need to manage people, I have to learn that people have feelings. People sometimes have good days, bad days, and people have skills again. I look at my people not because of what it says in the CVs. I say, okay, this person actually is good at doing this. So when we recruit people, we have what I call the happiness policy. When I recruit people, I ask people, so what is that you don't like? And then people say, oh, the tricky question. What are you going to say? No, I like everything. No. Let me know what is a general like. It's very important. The answer to this question is very important because in my team, if possible, nobody does something they don't like. People look at me like, are you weird? We try the people only do things they like. Very easy. When you do things you like, you do better. Right? So then when I recruit, I always try to get people that are complementary. You have people that are very process-driven, don't care if others are suffering or not, then you get people that are very, let's say, emotional and connected to the others. These are the green people. Also, there are some personality tests that you can be red, like a manager, blue, like a researcher, yellow, an innovator, and then there is the green, that is the social person. You need a bit of that in each team. Yes?
I'm interested in your opinion as a director and a recruiter. What if you read in someone's CV that they have changed PhD programs. Would that sound negative, or it's like, what would be your initial?
I would ask
cannot discard this person because they've mentioned that they started something and then they changed to something else. Would it be better to mention that?
You can mention why. You can put it out there. Why did you do that?
Yeah. Or just like leave it as a gap here.
No. And gaps, you know, my brother had a gap in his life. He finished, and then he decided he went to Ireland to work in a supermarket. He started with just putting milk, then he was the chief of the milk section, and then he left to Tenerife and worked as a cocktail person. And then he came back and he got a job. And people were asking him, why? What is this gap? I mean, what are you doing? And he's very philosophical. He said, you know, the brain is like a parachute. You can open it, it doesn't work, it's useless. So I got 2 years going around, enriching my life, enriching my experience, enriching my brain, and thanks to that, I have skills that now I'm going to get to the company.
I mean, you can always find good answers, you know, when being asked, but the thing is, like, would it sound negative? Would it look negative on a CV?
It's very, you know, that with the CVs, the problem is that there is no, it's very personal. The answer I give you is not the answer that would be good for another recruiter. And it's very, I'm telling you, it's extremely cruel. I have realized, you have 30 seconds, 15 seconds. Even if your CV is in the colors that this person doesn't like, maybe it has an impact on that person. So it's a question of luck. But it needs to be very clear. And again, it's not in the end when you recruit people, you're recruiting people. So people have lives. And people have gone through moments in their lives where things change, or got children, or, you know, hiring someone with a child has good things and bad things. The good thing, the bad things is that probably those children are going to be sick, and then that person needs time. In my team, I have my most senior and best researcher, she has 3 children. They get sick all the time. I say, stay at home with them. I don't mind when you come to the office and you deliver your job. Again, that's me, that's my company, okay? But what? I'm not going to make profit of her skills because she has 3 children and she's busy. The good thing is that there is no way she leaves tomorrow to anywhere. She's going to stay there. So, having families are good things. And bad things. Having a single person is good. Yeah, because you can make that person work 16 hours a day. Yeah, but also that person, once they say goodbye, I've got another job. Oh, yeah.
So,
a bit higher, otherwise, you know. For sure, you're super productive.
Oh, yeah.
Because at 5, she needs to leave. She cannot stay until 8, because I'm hungry, and kids are hungry at home. She needs to leave at 5. This means that if necessary, she's not going to do coffee breaks, she's going to be focused on delivery. I also recently read that women with 2 children reach their peak of productivity. Someone did some statistics about that. Okay? So, this picture, this is what is going to help the day of your defense. They're going to be terrified. So what's now? And the person next to you say, oh, finally. Finally, we could go on weekends and do things. because all of you have said, no, I cannot leave this weekend. No way, I have to write my dissertation. Then you did nothing during the weekend. Again, the problem with working or doing a PhD and working at university is that many times you work alone. You have people around you, but you work alone. And even if you are in a project with many people, people are really working alone. This means you don't have clear boundaries. This means your job is all over your life. At home, here, you take papers to read, at home, you do productivity very well. But then when you get into a normal job, you have boundaries. And if you get children, you need to leave at some time. So you need to get things done. So you become more and more productive. There is a book. This one. A PhD is not enough. It's not like an excellent book with all the answers you're looking for. But it's a book I bought in a moment of being desperate. In Amazon. You know, I started to look at things and I found this book. And I bought it. Very cheap. You can buy this used for $4. A new for $10, something like that. It's interesting because it's a book of a person that actually says, when you finish having a PhD, it's not enough. Companies are going to ask for many of the things. Many of the things that you have, but you don't know that you have. So that's why you need to do this kind of personal analysis. And you need to do this personal analysis to know again what is it you love, what is it you want to do, what is it you are good at, what is it you are ready to take, what's the pain in your life you want to take or not. Again, you just say, no, I'm not ready to work 16 hours because I have 4 children and I love them. And I want to experience being a mom or being a dad, so I don't work weekends. Sometimes you have, well, fine, but it's not like a rule. So you define boundaries. Since I do that, and I got all this white hair in these 4 years because they have been very intense, but actually psychologically I'm more healthy now than in the past. In the past, when I was doing my PhD, I was always anxious for this, oh, I need to publish. I need to get this published on the review on the next project, I need to meet the funding, blah, 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 blah. Now it's different, because I disconnect when I'm not in the office. Yes?
I have a question. Like, you present this, basically this option, either go to a company or stay in the university, and what about this kind of middle ground?
That's a good solution. I was keeping that for the end. Okay. International institutions. I mean, I work for a company, it's a private company, but it's like an international institution. United Nations, there are plenty of international institutions, Red Cross, United Nations, all kind of professional associations. Probably there's a professional association for people of history of Japanese. But again, there are plenty of international institutions and companies you have never heard about that need people like you. They pay well, and they are good places to work. Foundations, non-profit organizations, there are plenty of them. The problem is that now you are too busy with your PhD and you are not exploring. But that's what you need to do. And what is true is that it's not easy. So I would say 1 or 2 years before you deliver your PhD, you really need to start looking and planning. For example, I applied for my Marie Curie in 2007 for 2008. I delivered my PhD in 2009. Luckily, I didn't get it the first time, otherwise I would have been in trouble. But, you know, I got rejected. Preparing a Marie Curie application, it takes 5 months at least. Because you need to find a research institution that wants to host you. You need to agree on the topic, on the project. This, you know, requires time. And then you need to fill in the application. Applying for funding at an international level is tricky because what I have learned is that it's not the best project that wins. It's the best application. And the best application means that the reviewer actually has to review many of them. The reviewer wants to read the application from A to Z in a very easy, relaxed way. And not saying, what the hell is this? What is this person thinking? He has not read about this. Or, I don't understand. What does she mean? It's to be easy. Because actually reviewers, when they give you the total amount of points, if a section has 5 points, if they give you 5, that's it. But if they give you 1, they need to write down why they're giving you 1. So what is that reviewers want? They want to give you as many points as possible. So they don't have to write so much. But reviewers are picky people. I've been doing reviewing. I'm not crazy, I stopped it. It was not healthy for me. Because I got mad. Basically, oh, this person is not considering this or that, you know? And so that's why you need to work a lot in your application. It needs to be very easy to read, very clear, self-explanatory. And that you need time. I did it in 5 months, the second time. Okay? This year, in my department, we have applied for a Marie Curie with one person from Barcelona. We have done it in 1 month. But you know why? Because I knew how it works. I have gone through the process and I invested a lot of time in my free time to help that person because I'm interested in her coming to our team. And I'm happy with the result. Let's see what happens. But also there's another important thing, and that's one of the big mistakes of Spain in terms of research. The Marie Curie Fellowship Program has a network of national contact points. So if you go to Germany, for example, what you can do, not many people do, is that you contact them. Actually, they have a service to pre-assess your application. You give them your application, they read it, they give you back a report saying, listen, this paragraph of 10 lines, bullet points. Otherwise, nobody's going to read it. This paragraph that is in the third position, put it first. Because we want to know your goal from the very beginning. So, they give you very good advice. Your application is totally new afterwards and you get the money. Germany has that service. I think UK has that service. Switzerland has that service. Oh, surprise! These other countries getting most, the highest amount of Marie Curie's. Here in Spain, the Marie Curie contact point is at the Complutense University in Madrid. You call? Nobody answers. And then when someone says, yes, you got it. Yes, this process of review, what? We have nothing. What do you think? How many Marie Curie's does Spain get? So what happens in the end is that, and this is sad to say, I got my PhD here, all the benefit of it, money, talent, I've gone outside. But it's important that you start to look for these kind of international programs for funding. They are very complex in the rules, so you need to invest time in reading how they work, if you qualify, what type of projects, the different schemes that they have, where your project will fit. You need to get a host institution. So also what I say is, you know, stop doing holidays with your PhD. Your holidays are your conferences. Invest your money in getting to know people. It's essential. If you are not known, if you don't know professors that are interested in you, you will not be able to develop an academic career. You will not get a hosting institution that enables you to get funding. So you need to go to conferences, you need to socialize, you need to go to parties with researchers. Can be quite years on this. Yeah. More questions? What do you want to know? Come on. Yes?
To which point in my work the idea of being a freelance researcher?
Freelance researcher. It's difficult. It's very difficult because who does money? Who knows you? Are you well known?
No.
Are you an expert? Do you appear in newspapers?
No.
Who's going to hire you?
What? You can go to look for funding by yourself or just freelance for companies?
Yeah, I would say it's impossible. You can today with the internet and setting your profile and offering things and online, you can do many things. But it's true, in which field you are?
It's human-computer interaction. It's quite easy for the market connections.
So. Okay. I mean, why not? I mean, the path can be the path you choose. It's not that there are formulas. What I'm planning to do is when I get famous some years, then I will be a consultant, not a freelancer. Freelancer is poor. Consultant. You're a freelancer, they own the title, how much? No, we can't, we don't have the money, you need to be cheaper. If you're a consultant, you can ask for $2,000 a day with a problem. But to be a consultant, you need experience, you need... And sometimes, you know what I have realized is, I mean, we people are weird. And we focus many times on the superficial part of life. I got this job at the EBU. Before that, I must say, I used my Marie Curie to go all around. I went to all the conferences I wanted to go. That was the best thing, not the research, the postdoc I did. Okay, it was important. But the best thing, I went to all the conferences. I got more or less known the scene of my field. Still, when I would call places to get data or do things, nobody would know me. They would ignore me. Now I got hired in this company, I got a job title, like head of research. And whenever I call, they open the doors. But it's not because it's me. It's because I have a job in a company that has a reputation. And actually, I must say that I'm learning a lot in the process of working with a company. And I'm learning new things I didn't know about. So, I would say, yes, of course, you can do whatever you want. In certain fields, I think it pays off to get experience, to get network, to get knowledge in companies, because companies also position you. In 5 to 10 years, probably, I will be known in my field. In 4 years already, I see that people are starting to ask for me personally, not for the position. But maybe in 5 years, I get tired of working there, and then I can establish myself as a consultant. Because then people will ask for my expertise, not for the job title I have. It depends. But these things you cannot plan, honestly. These things happen. And the fact that things happen, it's a mix of you being prepared for that to happen, you working for that to happen, you being at the right place at the right moment, having gone to the right conference and get to know the right professor. Sometimes you are lucky enough that they don't like your working culture and they don't hire you, and then you get the job very fantastic. It's a bit of luck also. But of course, luck happens, but you need to be like cooking that. You need to be prepared. So, if I have an international career, it's because in 2004, I decided to leave. And then I got in love with a German, luck. And I left again. And then I was living in Germany, and things didn't work, and the Swiss thing happened. So, I didn't plan for this. But, I started to plan, who am I, what do I like, what am I good at, what's the pain I'm ready to take. And then, if you want to have an international career, you cannot sit down, then you need to move around. If you want to work in an international context with international companies, then you probably will have to go to another country. You need to promote yourself. You need to be active. I would say, you need to be active in any way that means. You need to be active. Things are not going to happen to you anymore. And research, as a thing you do, is not strictly connected to universities. There is plenty of research going on out there. So universities are part of the tree. You can stay, or you can go out, or you can do things. I'm going to say something I would like to say, but it's the reality. And please don't, it's going to sound very pretentious. I know. But I say it with great regret. My personal opinion at this moment is that those staying at the Spanish universities are those that cannot leave. Those staying are those that cannot leave. They cannot leave because they don't speak languages. They cannot leave because they don't have the personal push. They cannot leave because they have family situations that tie them here. And this is bad. This is bad because this has a negative impact on universities. I'm very concerned about the quality of teaching at universities. Teaching at universities is totally detached from the real world. Teaching at university is done by people that are very much frustrated, by people that are not well paid, by people that lose their enthusiasm and get institutionalized. How to change that? I'm afraid it's difficult because when we have a public, I mean, I really support having public universities. I don't support having public libraries. If you don't risk anything, if there is no threat of being fired, how are you going to give you the most of you? So I really support easy, quick, cheap, firing people. I know this sounds very neoliberalist. It's true. But if you have that, and at the same time, as I try to do in my team, you have the happiness policy, meaning I try to get prize and salaries every year for my people. They can go home wherever they want. They can take days off wherever they want. They do more holidays than official holidays. We hide that, but they do it. They work on the projects they like. They don't do things they don't like. That's why with four people, I can do 25 projects, more than 70 business trips combined, 450 information requests, and we still, after 4 years, come to the office being consciously happy and motivated, and we haven't had fights in 4 years. And yes, we can be fired tomorrow. We are going to be fired because we are delivering. We are delivering because we are motivated. So again, the point is, what is that drives you? What is that motivates you? And if it's Japanese history, of course, you need to keep doing that. But you need to find a way that the knowledge you have, what you have learned, gets translated into an activity. I'm not going to say a job, because a job is like a very formal, old-fashioned thing, but an activity that first reports income for you, and secondly, delivers values to someone. And this can be as a freelancer, this can be working here, delivering services online for all the world, this can be in an international organization, in a local company. Again, how much money you want, how much free time you want. These are the questions you need to make yourself. More questions? Yes?
You're talking in your work, you have this happy whatever policy, but this is normal in private companies, or this is more normal that they will make you work
No, it's not. It's not.
So, take the point.
But, yes, sorry, say.
My girlfriend is trying to move, and she's finishing now PhD 4 months, and she's trying to move. Probably to a private sector because she's utterly tired of the academia. The conditions you get in the private sector are best, are worst, are fixed.
What is best or worst depends. Because yes, you're going to be paid more, but it can be also tougher. I remember when I was at university, I was telling many people, listen, I don't get much money, but I have flexibility. So much flexibility that I work on the weekends. But it's true. Is anybody checking right here at 9? You make your break for this or that. Deadlines can be always extended. You can get relaxed. Professors forget what you promised. You don't do things until the professor has asked for the third time. Right? You can be, it's kind of comfortable sometimes, but can also be very damaging for your psychology. In a company, I mean, it's true, the business, the world of business, sometimes can be very cruel. And you've got many managers that they are only focused on profit, and they are very toxic, and they don't see you as a person, but as an asset, and they're going to squeeze everything out of you, because it's not your job. What matters is how many hours you're able to do. If you go for the money, and you're willing to get that pain, it's a fantastic option. I know people making 40, 50,000 euros a month. I don't want their lives. If you do marketing and you want to make money, go to Switzerland and work for tobacco companies. Philip Morris, blah, blah, blah. They have a problem of human resources. They cannot recruit people because people don't like to work for tobacco companies. A director of marketing makes 50,000 a month, plus car, plus pension plan, plus apartment, plus other benefits. But it's, you don't have a personal life and you work for a tobacco company. Again, do you want to do that for 5 years and then retire and become a freelancer even if you're unknown? Why not? So it depends on your values, again. And it's true that there are many companies that, what is happening is that many companies are still very old-fashioned in the way they manage people. But these companies are going to face problems with obtaining the best people. I must say most of you are millennials, right? The millennials kind of are a generation that kind of care for values. That's what we read in the statistics. And basically, many of you say, well, what does it cost? What is that? What are the values of your company? I need to understand that, and this needs to be meaningful to me. It's not that I'm going to sell myself. And I perceive that when I recruit young people, under 25, they call me some questions. I see the generational gap. But in many countries, like Nordic countries, anything happens first. Companies are starting to realize that this way of managing people is not sustainable. And many people, there's a point that money, bringing more money into your wage doesn't pay off because you don't have time to spend it if you're working too much. So in Sweden, for example, many companies include in the retribution package services like finding a school for your children, finding housing, supporting your partner to get a job. The companies, the lunch, they have a canteen or whatever. The food that has not been eaten is not thrown away, but made available for free for employees to get home for dinner. Many companies are starting to say, this is dangerous. You can have as many holidays as you want. They are not defined holidays. You take holidays whenever you want. The result in many cases is that people make fewer holidays because there's internal competition. So there are new ways of managing people, and you realize about that. The problem is that if you get to work for people that are 50 or older, most of the time they don't think in the same way. Well, they don't work for that company. Why do you want to work for a company that doesn't share your values? I mean, eventually you might have. You will have to do, because of course you need income, you need money, you need to support your family, pay schools, and blah, blah, blah. But as she said, if having four children is going to be a problem for the company, that's not the right place to be, because in the end, what is that you're working for? In my case, I think my job is an important component of my life balance and happiness. I do things that I see that have an impact, that improve society. We contribute in our way to improve society, and that is fulfilling for me. If I would be working in a consultancy company where they don't care about what I do, but just about how much money I invoice to our customers every month, I wouldn't feel that there's a purpose. I wouldn't be happy. So, when you go to a recruitment process, don't take this to the extreme, but think that they need you. They need you in the end, right? So you can also ask for things. Don't be too fancy, eh? Because also we get people who say, this is the first job. What's my career path? Where I'm going to be in 3 years, I'm going to be a director. So, well. I mean, you just graduated, relax. But it's true that you have skills and they are looking for that and they need it. So don't be afraid of asking. If you get to know, again, sorry for repetition, what is that you like, what is that you're good at, what is that the pain you're ready to take, ask about that to the company. Saying, listen, what's your working style? Are you asking people to work 16 hours? Big mistake. Because people cannot work 16 hours. What you do in hour 14 is crap. In Sweden, most of the many companies are starting to work 6 hours. Because if you focus 6 hours, the amount you deliver is, or the quality of what you deliver is good. And then go and rest. When I started at the EU, and I was so busy the entire day, those 8 hours. Honestly, I went to bed and I fell asleep on the sofa before the English program was finished. Because I was so exhausted, my brain had done so many things, it was so different to university. Now, I don't allow my people to do extra hours because I need them fresh the next morning. I mean, sometimes you have to, of course, there are problems and delays, but it's very important that companies understand that. Answering the question, not anybody has this style, of course. But then the question is, do you want to work for these people? Yes. Something and then been thinking on what I want to do. That's what my puzzle was about. So, first of all, what's a solution to an employment situation? So, I got money for 2 years. Fine, I got a job for 2 years. Secondly, the puzzle was good for me because actually it enabled me to develop a set of skills I had to work on during my PhD. Suddenly, I was my own boss. Suddenly, I had to recruit 2 people to help me with the research. I had to manage my budget, so I had to develop my Excel page to things. I had to calculate cost of things. I had to do many admin work, so project management. Without that, I couldn't do my job now. The postdoc allowed me to travel because I got money to go to all these conferences to get visible, to get prominent in my field of research. The postdoc allowed me to hire a coach. Honestly, the research that I did in my postdoc actually was very connected to the job I'm doing now because I did a research about how public service media reposition themselves in the digital and multi-platform scenario. how these traditional companies face developments. And that was the starting point of the main project I was leading. But that was kind of a casualty. What is true is that I went to the interview with my report. But you know, the report, nobody read the report, of course. They flipped the pages and they saw the graphics. And they liked the graphics. And the lady hired me because there were graphics in the report. And because she was asking me all that thing about what would you do, what would you do, what would you do. So she was not asking about my postdoc, my PhD. Anytime I tried to talk about that, I saw that she was like kind of not following. Okay? But whenever I used what I had learned to answer practical questions about how to solve problems, and this is very important. What is that you are? Researchers. What means to be a researcher? You are problem solvers. The first and most valuable skill you have is that you are people with knowledge, with attention to detail, with analytical capability, to be able to define what's the problem. What is the problem? You know how many hours people out there without the proper training spend talking shit about what's the problem? And they don't get it, man. And my friend, my colleague David and I, we get something nuts in our company because it's like people are so unskilled, they don't see things. And my wife questioned me and said, it's not that they don't see things, it's that you've got a training they don't have. You have been looking for problems, defining them, making your research questions, trying why. This capability to ask yourself why and define what's the problem and what you need to do to solve the problem is what is your added value. What happens is that in most of the cases, your way of solving problems is not very efficient because you need 3 years or 4 years or 8 years to solve a problem. Now we solve problems in half an hour sometimes, or in 6 months, the longest. And it's working because again, we've got those skills. So the postdoc, I think it's good for you to do it as a solution, a personal solution, but also as a way to have 1 or 2 years to make this master plan you need to do to get into your research, to be part of your life, and to have a happy life. And of course, you can also travel and go to another place, that's always good. So I would suggest always to do a postdoc. Depends on the field. Sometimes you get a job. If you don't get a job, then you can use the opportunity also. What else? Yes?
So, given that international relationship, you also need to take into account your partner.
Yes.
And that's different because also it's just from different cuts over party tips or pitfalls that you can.
Well, for those that read German, my wife wrote a book about that. I can't recommend it yet. Well, in my case I was lucky enough. My wife, she's a freelance journalist. And the moment we moved to Geneva, is when we had our first son. She was the one, let's say, accommodating to my situation. Previously, I had accommodated because I moved to Germany and I spent 7 years there. And I moved without speaking German and without having a job. But I had my job here and I was flying for teaching and all these things. So again, you probably need to make a plan like that if it happens. Yes, it's true. And that's the problem, that sometimes you need to get a couple that is very different to you in that sense. Because if the two of you want to do research, it's going to be tough. Right? So in that case, be a freelancer. A freelancer is great. Freelancers can be more. If it's something that is online, even better. But it's true. It's again also the pain you are willing to take. My wife, she's She's a journalist. She was a freelancer in Hamburg. She had a very good connections there. She was writing for newspapers and magazines there. Now we're in Geneva. She, of course, can maintain some relations, but many of them also have died because of distance, because you sometimes need to see people. Internet is not the solution for everything. Also, the money we make in Germany is only allowing you to have coffee in Geneva, because the difference of income. So now that she's working again, she has redefined her career. Now she trains people in the startups how to get press coverage by newspapers. And she has developed her online business model for that. So, we can also get a training about that. I can give you a reference. But it's true. What to say? I don't know. I used the puzzle to get married. I used the puzzle to go on holidays. I didn't do holidays for a long time because I invested my time in going to conferences. And I must say that I really think that was a key factor in my career. That I invested, I mean, it was, of course, work, but also you take some days and get to know the cities. But I think that I invested, universities are not ready to pay every single trip you want to do. So I invested my personal money in going to conferences. Because then when I applied for the Marie Curie, I think it's not necessary anymore. But I need 3 recommendation letters from professors. And I got them because they got to know me. And it's because I invested in going to those conferences. So the puzzle also gave me the opportunity then to do proper holidays, to get married, to get my first son. Yeah, well, kind of important too. But yeah, it's tough. And if you get kids, of course, it gets even more difficult with moving them around. I mean, when they're small, you can move them like a package, it's okay. It's more difficult when they start to get to school. Also, it's weird in the sense that how important is your culture to you? Because I'm Spanish, my wife is German, we live in French-speaking Switzerland. My children speak Spanish and German, and others French. They are going to be French speakers. What the hell is that? Sorry, you know, French-speaking people have special relations. Of course. It also, sometimes we talk about it like, are we doing the right thing being here in Geneva? Because these kids are going to be, they already talk among themselves in French, 2 and 4. The oldest one, Neil, he speaks the 3 languages very fine. But Mateo is 2. He doesn't speak yet properly because he has been dealing with the 3 languages at the same time. Neil was probably with 2, then he learned French in 6 months. But Mateo still, and Mateo, most of the words he says are French. When he wants more, Neil was saying mass, or not mal, Mateo says in cop. So, again, are you ready to accept that your children are going to be talking a different language and you will not get to, well, somehow there? What else? What worries you? Why are you fierce? Why are you afraid? Yes? In Barcelona, a few people.
Yeah.
Well, Barcelona has a very good thing. It's a city everybody wants to be. Right? It's cool. The problem is that salaries and cost of life is not very well adjusted. Barcelona is more expensive than Geneva in relative terms. Like things in Geneva cost 4 times more, but you make 4 times more or more than here. Okay? Spain has a problem. Spain doesn't have the right conditions in many cases to, if you want to be an entrepreneur, you want to create your company, you want to, it's difficult. There are many other countries in Europe that are easier. To create a company here is super difficult. Yeah, it is. So, but again, sometimes listen, creating a company is a pain. You need to look for money, you need to look for customers, you don't have experience. You're going to be, you are not a researcher anymore. You become a manager.
And
yes, I mean, nothing is impossible. What I'm saying is that, personally, I think that there are so many companies, and good companies, and so many organizations that already have the infrastructure there, that investing the effort in creating that yourself, again, don't underestimate the pain. And being your own boss and having to reach the customers. The good thing for me in the last 4 years was that I had to create like a company, has like been creating a consultancy company. We have the money and we have the customers. So we could focus on the service. And that's why we are all very happy. If I would have had to do the same on my own, but it's because that I'm not that kind of person. At the moment, maybe in 5 years, I get tired of my organization and I say, you know, I got the right contacts, I know in the market, so I could easily be on my own, being hired for 2 or 3 projects of 30 to 50,000 each. I don't need more, I can live with that. And then I move to Barcelona because it's cheaper. I'm living in Chile. So, yeah, please.
I was wondering whether you have experience either from yourself or by doing it yourself or receiving self-initiated applications?
Yes. Why not? I mean, you never know. People are looking. For example, now I have a problem. I need to fire one of my employees, the person that is taking care of the marketing and producing our reports and everything. The process is not open yet, because I'm never sharing with my bosses how to do that. But if I will receive nowadays a curriculum, someone doing marketing, actually it will be very useful. So yeah, apply. And especially if you see a company where, but applying doesn't mean spamming, eh? Because spamming is very annoying. And actually puts you in a blacklist. We have a person. Like this. Because she sends us all the time things. And we haven't had a call in 4 years, so I don't know why she doesn't get it. But we're not interested in her profile. But I think you need to study and analyze the companies. And you need to apply, if you apply spontaneously, actually because you think you can bring something to that company. So it's not just me what is valuable, it's your idea. So I'm applying to your company because I see you do this and I think I could bring this that would be of value to you. Why is that? Because these companies receive CVs all the time. And why should they consider you? There are many people with a PhD, there are many people that are better than you are. But the idea is why it's important. Doesn't matter if you have a postdoc or not, it's the idea. In my team, I have a person doing market trends and analysis of consumption, of media consumption. She got a degree in fashion design. How is that she came to do this? Because then she got a job, blah, 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 blah. Finally, she's doing this. Okay? And it's because she's good at that. She has a sense for understanding what people do. Maybe the fashion design, you know, help her to understand what people like to wear. She's the green person in my team, takes care of all of us, we're happy. But you can apply. It's true that the rate of success for that is not very high, I must say. And there is also, where do you apply? The problem is that if you send it to human resources, forget. See, people in human resources, they are like the gatekeepers. And it's good if you try to target the right person.
Thank you.
the right manager, the right person, the team. And then you need, I think you need to be soft, you need to be subtle, because also everybody has a tendency to become a gatekeeper. And then you receive a city, oh, but this person wants a job from us. So again, it's not that you are selling yourself, you are selling an idea, a package of skills. And you need to be subtle in the sense that if you sound too desperate, they will say, why? It's difficult, I don't know how to explain it. What else? Yes?
Could I communicate with the skills of a PhD without a PhD? Because usually, like, it's not often said, basically, a PhD is not sufficient, it's necessary.
Yes. Yes, I agree with that. Because again, but it's necessary not because of the PhD degree. Nobody has asked for my paper. Oh, well, yes, I want to be I want to be a physics supervisor. I have to do so many papers to demonstrate I'm suitable for that. So they're asking for, scan your PhD, show me how many things you have done. I don't have time for that. You want me to supervise or not? Okay? I think it's necessary again because the PhD, the treatment you started, the treatment has been training you for 4, 6, 8 years. This treatment has changed you. You are not the same person. And this is necessary for you to deliver what you are able to deliver now. That's what you need to put into words in a way that other people can understand without sounding pretentious. Because if you go and say, well, I can deliver something that nobody else can do, and no, of course, it doesn't sound good. But I think it's, yeah. Do you follow Freud? Yes. This website. It's your life, right? It's like this, in many sense. It's something that, in many cases, that I was reading and I was laughing about. But at the same time, then, what I see is that, in some cases, this website, or these comics, is also making profit of your frustrations and showing you life in a way that, you know, it's like this, you cannot change it. It has to be like this. Again, it's a system of beliefs that you need to comply, and a suffering and a pain that you need to take, and you are going to be better in the future. No. I mean, you are very skilled people. And you know, I'm convinced that many of you could work for me. Even if you have the Japanese thing. You know? Because, you know, I wouldn't ask you, tell me about Japanese history. I will talk to you as a person who say, okay, what is that? What's your name, sir?
Jonathan.
What is that you are passionate about? Don't tell me that. Okay? But, you know, if you like reading, if you like understanding why people behave in a certain way, if you like this and that and this, then I say, listen, Jonathan, you know what? Maybe you can work doing media consulting. You don't have the knowledge for that now. I don't care. Because I'm sure in 6 months you will be able to be mastering that if we give you the right training. If we give you the 3 or 4 books you need to read, if you go to 3 or 4 conferences, and if you know, and if we get to achieve that you are passionate about that, the same way you are passionate about the Japanese stuff, you're going to be fantastic in that team. So, again, don't get obsessed with your topic, with your subject. Life is not only your thesis topic. Again, in many cases, this is going to be irrelevant. You are going to discover when you go out there that what you need actually was useless. Because, have you seen this graphic? When you finish school, you would have to represent your knowledge. How is your knowledge? Like this. you get a bachelor of knowledge like this, right? And then you make a master, and you start to go more in a certain direction, right? And then you get to your PhD. What's a PhD? If this would be all the existing knowledge in the world, what is a PhD supposed to do? A PhD is supposed to go to the frontier and make an exceptional contribution, right? So you're supposed to add a sandstone here. This is your PhD. But there is a fundamental problem that universities have not understood. How the hell do you jump from here to here? How do you know that? The answer would be professors. Professors are the ones that are living here, right? Supposed to. And professors should tell the kid, read this book, read that book, take this course, do this. So, it's like a high-speed train from here to here. What's your real path? Go here, then you come here, and then you have here, 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 and maybe your dissertation ends here. And basically, in many cases, because theoretical figures are so important, you keep rewriting the 50 books you have written. Summarize them, reproduce the same tables, do the same experiments to validate that actually what some people say is okay, and we are all okay. Where's the contribution of the PhD? But also the problem is that real life is happening now here. And the people in the broadcasters I'm dealing with, you know, they don't talk about all this. They have problems to solve problems. They have real problems. They don't get to connect with young people that aren't watching TV. And then you get all these people at the university that are talking about the media studies and all the studies. But they don't have the data. They cannot analyze it. So, how we do this trick? You need to be here. And I don't know why I'm explaining this. I don't know what's going on in my discourse. I hope it's useful. So, that's the problem. So the point is, if you know something you like, if you like the Japanese history thing, sorry, I'm using just an example, but it's very useful.
I think useful.
So, that's good. So, where are you, Jonathan? Where are you?
I think outside.
You're outside?
I worked outside for many years working in companies. And then I came to university, so my background is kind of even way better than working now in Japanese history. So now I'm going alone, because there's no one who can teach me about this topic here. I'm going alone to the line, the observed line of the
Okay, ready now? Who else in the world is doing here, is doing that? That's also what you need to ask. The problem is that, as it happened to me, I studied in this university, I got my PhD in this university, because nobody told me, kid, if you want to do a PhD, you need to, first of all, when we all write our PhD topic in the beginning, it's like, enormous, we want to solve the whole thing. But we don't know who is doing what. That's the problem. Even with the internet, even with academia.edu, we don't know who is doing what. So before you choose your research, even when you are doing your research, invest time in finding out who the hell is here. And talk to these people. Because these people for sure need help. And they need fresh blood and they need enthusiasm. But if you don't look for these people, this is the most fundamental part of your PhD. If you don't look for these people, everything you do is useless because you want to have someone here. And when you think, oh, look, my PhD is great, someone will come and say, you are 3 decades behind. Who is here? Or who is here? You need to find those people. So now if I would say, if someone in Europe is doing a PhD on public service media, and he must be talking to me, that person is going to be doing something useless. And it's not to give importance to myself. But we are, in my company, the ones having the most advanced knowledge on this, on the real life. So who is having the most advanced, and this works better with science, with natural science and engineering, because of course you need to know what is there to improve that. With social science, the problem is that we just read books in many cases. And of course, if you don't go to the right library, you don't get the latest books. But today we have something that is called the internet. So use that. Also, because if you look who is there in your frontier, you are identifying potential employees, you are making your life easier because something has already done the job, so you can actually add something. So be very honest with you. I think that if today, I would be happy if today you leave this session with something. You need to ask yourself who you are. What is that you like? Not what is that you want to be. What is that you like? What is the pain you're willing to take? What is that you are good at? And finally, in your field, who are the top researchers? And if you don't know them, you are late. Who are the top researchers? Now for sure they are here. Okay, yes. If you are lucky enough, then you will be able to stay in Barcelona. But if not, maybe you need to leave. Or maybe you don't need to leave, but you need to contact them. And you need to see where they are and what is that they have done. And you need to understand that research is not only university. There are plenty of companies, of international institutions, of professional associations, of non-profit organizations, of state agencies that are doing research in different ways. And in many cases, employers take 15 to 30 seconds to scan your CV the first time, and they don't care about how many degrees you have, they will be necessary, but they are not what is giving you the job. It's the skills. And finally, if you want to be happy and you have answered all those questions, you have a kind of a plan, or several plans, you need to work actively in positioning yourself so luck will find you. But you need to position yourself. You need, if you want an international career, you need to be international. Otherwise, you're not going to have it. And let things happen. That's it. As I said, I have solutions, and my experience maybe is biased, but many people, you are great, you have knowledge, you have skills. You need to believe in yourself, and you need to work in a plan. Good.